Good morning and welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. Oh, what a joy it is to have you here. You having fun with the crayons? Oh, awesome. We got some awesome stuffed animals over here too. So welcome on this beautiful Sunday morning. Wow, the temperatures are cool. Much cooler from Kentucky where I just came back from vacation. So feels nice. Thank you. Thanks, Wanda. It's good to be back. I've missed you all very much. It was good to be with family and friends that I hadn't seen in a year. But it's so much better to be back home always, right? Okay, will you pray with me? Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come into your presence today hungry, thirsty for your word, for you, for your Holy Spirit. We've prepared ourselves to come here seeking different things for each person. And you know these needs, these desires. We lay our burdens here for you to pick up and carry so that we are free to do your work in the world. Fill us, Lord, with your presence here today. And thank you for being a good, good father. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So let's do some singing. Feel free to stand as you feel led or as you're able. And we're going to start with All the People Said Amen. Or not. Are the monitors on? The speakers on? I didn't do a check of this before I came in up here, so I don't know. Todd's in control back in the back. Got the control center going, so we know that he'll get that up and going here soon. Now we'll get the words going. It'll come up along with it. We'll get the whole thing going here in a minute. Yes, and then everybody will say amen. You are not alone.
If you are lonely, when you feel afraid, you're not the only. We are all the same. In need of mercy, to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God.
And all the people said amen. Whoa.
And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the poor for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Amen. You may be seated. Oh, what a wonderful way to start worship. And we're going to continue on now with some words of reflection to connect us with Michelle. Thank you.
You're welcome. Good morning. So I wanted to share with you this morning some things that I learned while at annual conference last week. I think Brian and I and Pam and Laura and Jeff and Emma had an opportunity to attend our annual conference in Denver. And I went to a food scarcity cafe, it was called. It was a little workshop. Many of you may or may not know that our bishop, Bishop Karen, has claimed or named the next quadrennium, the next 4 years, to living into beloved community. And there's a big emphasis this year and next year on water, or food scarcity and clean water. And so the workshop I went to talked about food scarcity. And these happen to be Colorado statistics just because it was the conference was in Colorado. I'm sure that they're probably not a whole lot different than what we experience in Wyoming. And ours may actually be a little bit worse because we have more food deserts, if you will, especially in rural areas of Wyoming, than what they have in a more populated state of Colorado. But 1 in 8 people in Colorado is hungry. 1 of 5 kids in Colorado is living in poverty. And 1 of 7 senior citizens will wonder where their next meal is coming from, which I kind of found shocking. They also said 25% of our military, our armed forces, qualify the food stamp program, which is now called SNAP. When you're on the SNAP program, and they jokingly said that with the, some of you may or may not know, it used to be called food stamps because you literally got stamps. Now you get like a debit card, and it's called an EBT, Electronic Benefits Transfer Card. And so I know when Andy was working for Department of Family Services, they implemented the EBT card. Terry Williams, some of you know, from the Wyoming Home Ownership Program, was actually the creator of bringing the EBT card to Wyoming. And one of the things that they started the EBT card versus the food stamps was they cut about $30,000 a month in fraud out of the system. And so someone jokingly said at this workshop I was in that there's actually less credit card or food stamp fraud occurring now than the fraud that goes on in Congress. I'm not sure that that's true. That was just, I'm just relaying that message. But interestingly enough, if you're on the SNAP program, they give you $1.40 per meal daily. And I don't know if any of you have tried to live on $4.20 for your but they actually had a pastor there who had taken that challenge. And that was extremely interesting. And they did a little video that I think is going to be available to congregations, a DVD, a quick thing that he talked about where he tried to do meals on $4.20 a day. Michael Pollan, a famous chef, said that food is not just about fuel. It's about family, community, and identity. And if you think about that, probably most of you have celebrations, family celebrations, that focus around food. The Martin celebrated Brian's birthday yesterday. I'm sure there was food there. If you've been to a graduation party at the Ingerly House this year, you probably had food. If you go to Thanksgiving dinner, it probably focuses around food. We're Methodist. We focus around food. Yeah. Obviously, you do not get this girlish figure by being anorexic. I'm just saying. So one of the things I wanted to just point out to you all is that Andy and I had the opportunity and the privilege this morning to serve breakfast at Comia. Yesterday was Super Day. And so we got there at 6 o'clock. The menu was French toast and bacon. However, last night after Super Day, they had Taco John's brought them about 100 breakfast burritos. And so we were able to serve those. They had kept them overnight refrigerated, and they reheated them this morning. We served those to about 45 people. in our community that were not going to have breakfast otherwise. They're serving about 90 a day for dinner. And we all know that this is summertime and a lot of people are passing through Wyoming. But there are people in our community that are homeless year-round. And they had a keynote speaker at one of the sessions at conference who is a doctor in the Denver community at a clinic. She's had the privilege to go through medical school training and made a decision that she wanted to work with the people on the fringe and work in low-income clinics. And she gave her testimony, and I'm just going to give you a brief synopsis of it. But basically, she was doing all these hours in the clinic. She had her medical practice going. And she turned her head one morning when she woke up, and she heard her neck snap. And she thought, boy, that was loud. Well, she had severed an artery in her neck that started to cause seizures, strokes, and cerebral hemorrhaging. And she was unable to work. Well, her husband is a stay-at-home dad because they have two children, and it was more cost-effective for him to stay at home than to be out in the workforce. And they have an older home in Denver. And she said she was unable to work. She couldn't see clients. She was out of work for about 8 months. And she said, you know, after about the first 2.5 weeks, they had gone through all the food that they had in their cupboards and in her pantry. And because she was a doctor, the neighbors didn't know that they needed food. People in the community didn't need food. But that they were actually didn't know where their next meal was going to come from. And she said that it was extremely humbling to her to all of a sudden be on the other side. And she woke up in the middle of the night one night and thought, oh my gosh, we qualify for SNAP. So she went and applied for SNAP. And she said the first day when they were able to go to the grocery store, and I'm going to probably get teary-eyed because I go to the grocery store so much that my husband almost has to beat me to get me to go in the summertime because I'm a home ec teacher, so I go every day in the wintertime. And she said they went into the grocery store, and she said to her little boy, you can pick whatever you want. And he said, can I have chocolate ice cream? She said, yes, you can have chocolate ice cream. And they got to the checkout stand, and the lady that was checking them out said, oh, it must be somebody's birthday. What are you celebrating? And the little boy looked at her and he goes, we get to buy groceries. And she didn't really get the concept of that. But it became a big celebration day every month, the time of the month. And I didn't know this, that you get your SNAP benefits on whatever the last number is in your Social Security number of the person who applied. So theirs happened to come on the 6th of each month. So on the 6th of each month, it was like a big celebration because they grocery store and buy groceries. And she said at one point their toilet broke. They were having to use buckets in the bathroom. They couldn't have friends over because they were embarrassed and ashamed of how they were having to live. And she said that when she went back to work, she was only able to go back for an hour a day because she would just get so physically exhausted. And she showed pictures of her home. She said, you know, we never moved into the doctor ghetto. And I was like, wah. But she said, we never, you know, thank goodness, we had never gone out and bought a multi-million-dollar house. We'd gotten new cars and had car payments, or we never would have made it. And she showed her bathroom floor, you know, needs to be replaced. Her kids, because their basement had flooded while that she was laid off and had sewage backup in the basement and things, the kids have bunk beds that are in their master bedroom with her and her husband's bed. And it was just eye-opening that I don't think you realize that there are people probably in your neighborhood, no matter where you live in Cheyenne, that probably are going hungry or don't know where their next meal is going to come from. And so I would just encourage you all to think about this next year, food scarcity and water cleanliness. I know that last year the Daddy Bruce Ministries gave away about 57,000 Thanksgiving meals in downtown Denver. And you may say to me, yeah, but Michelle, there's people who abuse that. You know what? There are. I'm sure there are. I have students in my school that I'm sure abuse Friday food bags. But you know what? God's going to sort that out. My call is just to minister and to be the person that provides it. And he's going to sort it out. So I would challenge you to be the vessel, provide, and to be open and responsive. And if something tells you that maybe you need to share some of your excess produce from your garden this summer, or maybe you made too much for dinner last night and you're tired of leftovers, there's somebody in our community and somebody who would enjoy eating those leftovers and probably would look forward to it. They did say that Denver has no Section 8 housing because the housing market is so high. There's no subsidized housing. And that it takes $22.75 just to make a living wage if you live in downtown Denver. And I know that there's been some studies done here by our First Lady, Nancy Freeman, First Lady. if you go on the Workforce Services website, there's actually a living calculator, a living wage calculator. You put in your information, like whether you want roommates or not, how many kids you have, and it will actually tell you how much you need to make per hour just to make a living wage, and that's without a vehicle. Here in every county in Wyoming, it will do that calculation for you. And Laramie County tends to be high just because of the state government and the college, and because we have a better work situation than a lot of our rural counterparts. So anyway, have a blessed week and vessel that God's called you to be.
Thank you, Michelle. And all the people said, amen. Amen. Yes. Thank you. Wow. Connection and reflection on how you can be connected in your community, in our nation, and in our world, and be those superheroes. Oh, that's awesome. You know, you made me think of some people in my neighborhood. Thank you. Let's continue with our time of praise worship with our last song, Good, Good Father.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never. Good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers.
Not everyone has had a good father in their life. And we just celebrated Father's Day last Sunday. And I hope that you had an opportunity to celebrate those father figures in your lives. The fact that you are a father and that you were able to celebrate with your children. But if you've not had those positive experiences, I hope that you always know that we have the ultimate father, the ultimate superhero in God, our Father. This concludes our praise portion of worship. So I invite you now to prepare your hearts, minds, and your spirits as we continue on with the rest of our worship today. Amen.
Tiny bit confused on that. Lord, I trust in your steadfast love.
Oh. Shall rejoice in your salvation.
I will sing to the Lord because God has dealt beautifully with me.
My heart shall rejoice in your salvation.
Remember the covenant and be thankful. Join us in hymn number 117, O God, our past and ages, our help in ages past.
in this mic, Todd. So this summer, we're going to be doing some readings from our Old Testament, and many of them are stories. And so what we're going to do is I'm calling Reader's Theater for these scripture stories. So instead of just somebody reading scripture, it's going to be acted out. So enjoy that. Know that we have some places where we need more persons to read. And after you read today and you're willing to sign up, we need two readers for next week. It's not too hard. But enjoy this way of interacting with the scripture that we haven't done before.
After a period of time, God decided to put Abraham to the test.
Abraham?
I'm right here.
Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom I know you love deeply, and go to the land of Moriah. When you get there, I want you to offer Isaac to me as a burnt offering on one of those mountains. I will show you which one.
Abraham did as he was told. Early in the morning, he got up, saddled his donkey, and taking two of his trusted servants with him and his son Isaac, he cut the wood for the burnt offering and traveled to the place God had told him about. On the third day of the journey, Abraham looked up and saw the place far in the distance. Abraham leaves Beersheba as he left Haran many years earlier. God calls and he leaves. It is as simple as that. No map, no directions. Just an unwavering trust that God will lead him where he needs to go. Mount Moriah becomes one of the most important places in all of the Promised Land and the one place in the world set apart for the worship of the one true God. According to 2 Chronicles 3:1, Solomon builds his temple on Mount Moriah in Jerusalem, not where God tests Abraham.
Servants, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to meet you here.
Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and set it on the shoulders of his son Isaac to carry, and Abraham himself carried the fire and the knife. The two of them walked on together.
Father.
I'm right here, son.
Look, we have the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?
God will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son.
Two of them continued to walk together when finally arrived at the place God had shown him. Abraham took some stones and built an altar there and arranged the wood carefully on top of it. Then he bound his son Isaac with rope and laid him on the altar on top of the stack of wood. Just as Abraham reached over to grab the knife that would kill his son, the special messenger of the Eternal One called his name from heaven.
Abraham! Abraham!
I'm right here.
Don't lay your hand on the boy or do anything to harm him. I know that you respect the one true God and will be loyal to him and follow his commands. Because you were willing to give up your son, your only son, to me.
Abraham glanced up and saw a ram behind him with its horns caught in the thicket. He went over, dislodged the ram, and offered it up as a burnt offering in the place of his son. From that day forward, Abraham called that the Eternal One will provide. Because of this, people still today, on the Mount of the Eternal, all will be provided. The special messenger of the Eternal One called out to Abraham yet a second time from heaven.
Listen to the solemn vow the Eternal One has spoken. Because you have done what I asked and were willing to give up your son, your only son, I will reaffirm my covenant of blessing to you and your family. I will make your descendants are as many as the stars of the heavens and the grains of sand on the shores. I reaffirm my earlier promises that your descendants will possess the lands and sit in the gates of the enemies, and from your descendants all the peoples of the earth will discover true blessings. All this is because you have obeyed my voice.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And kiddies, come forward for children's moments.
Good. And we're not going to be sitting. We're going to be getting up and doing something. Yeah. You might want to just. Yeah. Okay. Hey, do you want to say your name in the microphone? It's kind of fun to hear it. My name's Glenda. What's yours?
Eli.
All right. Say it louder.
Eli.
Did you hear that? Coming through the speakers. What's your name?
Paxton.
All right. Well, welcome. Welcome. Who are you?
Emma.
Oh, and who are you?
Barbara.
Okay. So we're kind of doing a sermon series this summer about superpower, right? We're talking about the superpowers that, you know, God has given us. So do you feel like you know your superpower? Do you have a superpower? You don't know? Gosh, maybe I should let you know what your superpower is, a superpower. Do you have a superpower? You do. Do you want me to share with you what your superpower is? You want to know today what your superpower is? What about you, Emma?
Caring.
Caring is her superpower. All right. Power?
Be happy.
That's right. Oh, man. If you know Barb, yes, of course that is. Well, I live with a person that does have a superpower. And just this week, a huge research project has been released on brain research, and it is about the power of hugs. So if you know Levon, you know the power of hugs. And I just have to laugh because the whole thing says you shouldn't give quick hugs, you should give long, substantial hugs, and it releases a ton of serotonin out of your brain. So I laugh. My son has special needs. That means he needs a lot of help in his life. And so luckily there's a lot of people there to help him. But he hugs, and he hugs long, and it says that's the way it should be. And I laugh because there's an entire group of people out there that IEPs have been written by the 10 millions, do not hug. And I thought, oh, I have a whole different view on hugs now. So we're going to learn the power of not just one hug, but a spiral hug. Have you ever had a spiral hug? Hey, all right. Okay, so who wants the hug? Of all of us here, who wants the hug? You want the hug?
Barb gets the hug.
Okay, yeah. So she's at the end. The rest of us are all over here.
I'll be at the end of the line.
We'll give you your crayons and pictures back, buddy. Okay. Stay put.
superpower this week. So right now, think of who you're going to hug this week and make sure to keep giving them hugs, okay? Because that's your superpower, okay? Amen.
Amen.
When I heard Michelle sing water, God's word, I was thinking about your reflection connection, that water is a gift. So, as we continue, I invite you to pray with and for me. Let us pray. Gracious God, hug us with your spirit. Speak to our hearts and ignite our passions for whatever message you have to give to us today. Amen. Well, thank you for the Reader's Theater who read a very difficult story. Has anybody heard that story between Abraham and Isaac before, the sacrifice of Isaac? Saw that and you thought, why in the world would Reverend Laura choose that passage to read? You ain't seen nothing yet. You ought to see the rest of the sermon series that we have. If there's anything I'm not afraid to do is grab the controversial passages, the ones that we don't like to listen to. But this idea, and it's the Sunday after Father's Day. And here we come to a passage that isn't what I think we would read on Father's Day. Whether we think of God the Father, or whether we see Abraham as Father, where God says, Abraham, you should kill your son. And Abraham says, sure, Dad, whatever you say. Does that shock anybody else? Anybody else shocked with it? Yes, yes, it is shocking, especially when we believe, and I think Scripture proves that God is a loving God of mercy. God is also a God of challenge. And I will say that this passage has challenged people, Jews and Christians, for millennia. My last semester in seminary, anybody ever been to college and you've audited a class? So audit means you go to the class, but you don't have to take the test, which means sometimes you don't go to the class because there's no accountability with it. Well, I audited a class. The only reason I went to the class more regularly because there was this really cute guy I was dating that was in the class with me. I'm now married to him, so you don't have to go tell your dad any stories. So I would go to the class to make sure I spent time with my boyfriend, who was knee-deep in class, I'll tell you that. But it was a class on the Talmud, which is a collection of writings in the Hebrew Scriptures. And what I discovered is that rabbinical writers, rabbis, throughout the past have written documents like commentaries in a way. And so through that whole semester, we looked at all the commentaries from all these different rabbis across the ages, and what passage did they look at? Genesis chapter 22, the story of Abraham called to sacrifice his son. What I learned in that class is, number one, the Jews are not afraid to accuse God of what they think is wrong. They are not afraid to argue with God. The rabbis were saying, how can the God of the Exodus, the God of salvation, require this of a father? I think sometimes we Christians set aside God as this perfect being. God kind of is. But I think we put this distance between us and God that we don't say, God, I have a problem with. And so that was the first thing I learned. The second thing I learned is that there are a lot of challenges with this passage, and we shouldn't be afraid to say, I'm uncomfortable. This doesn't make sense, or this is challenging. I believe that God can handle it. I believe if we say, God, in your scripture is something I don't understand, God is not going to say, well, there's something wrong with you if you don't understand it. God and says, well, tell me what you think. Let's talk about it. And through reading these rabbinical, I discovered, much like the psalmist, we may begin with accusing God, but we often work our way around to saying, but I know, God, I can still trust you, even if I don't understand, even if it's a challenge. So think of that when you listen to this passage again, when you read it again, or when I challenge you with some of the words that I'm going to share today. Because today we are looking at this passage, and I'm going to ask you, who is the superhero in this passage? So the first superhero that we could claim is Abraham. So how many of you have heard of Abraham before? What do you know about Abraham? Just tell me, what do you know about Abraham? Many sons. That's from the song. It's not from the scripture. What else do we know about Abraham? He was really old when he became a dad. What else do we know about Abraham? He's the father of Israel. Literally, actually. He's a busy boy. He lies. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are the three. Abraham gave birth to Isaac, who gives birth to Jacob, and Jacob was the trickster. But they all three have some similarities, but you're right. Which Jacob, by the way, became the name Israel. But I think we get to that story next week. I can't remember. What else do we know about Abraham? We know that he is the first patriarch of the Bible. And the word patriarch in this politically correct climate today, and being a self-avowed feminist, I can say it's not a word that I like. Yet from a historical standpoint, this is one of the first fathers of the Jewish faith that Jesus claimed. Even as Christians, we can claim that as well. Yes, we do know that Abraham was probably, I think it said 75 years old, when he was called by God to leave his homeland and go to a place that was yet to be determined. I'm not going to ask you how many of you are 75 years or older. I'm not going to. But if you are around that age, and God says, I want you to pack up and leave your family behind to a specified yet to be determined location, how many of you would go? You're not close to that age, so you can't answer. Just think about that. You don't really have to raise your hand. But that's how old he was when he was called to leave his father's land and to go to a new one. 75 years old. He was already married to Sarah. They have different names. I'm just going to call them Abraham and Sarah, even though scripture has them Abram and Sarai earlier on. But they were married and they had no children. Once again, if you were around the age of 70 and you've not ever had children, would you ever expect to have children? So, a childless couple, some of us aren't even over that age, and we know that we don't imagine that happening. A childless family of a certain age goes where God leads them. That would be a superpower. As they go, though, there is a little trickster get into trouble by lying thing. You see, Abram was following God, obedient to God. But then when they get into Egypt because there's a famine, in order to protect his wife, he didn't say, this is my wife. He said, this is my sister, Sarah. And eventually Pharaoh discovers and gets really mad and sends them away. You can read the rest of the story before chapter 22 to find out why he does this. But what I want to identify is that there was a time that Abraham was not completely truthful. He lied. And who did he trust? Did he trust in God to provide? Instead, he trusted in his concerns and his fears and his worries. We also, God had promised to Abraham, even though you're in your 70s, even though you're in your 80s, even though you're in your 90s, you are going to be a father of many. And he's looking at his barren wife going, yeah, how's that going to happen? And his barren wife, Sarah, says, yeah, how's that going to happen? And so they take it into their own hands, and they said, well, we're not going to have babies on our own. So Abraham, here is Hagar. Sarah says, Abraham, here is Hagar, my handmaiden. She can have a baby for you. So she has a baby for Abraham. His name was Ishmael. Now, you would think that Sarah asked her husband to have a baby with her servant, you think that Sarah would be happy with that, and she wasn't. We also know that, so you set up a little conflict in the family. See, even our superheroes have feet of clay. We also know that at one point, there are three visitors that visit Abraham and Sarah. And they said, ah, we can see how faithful you are, and you, your wife will have a child. In fact, Sarah isn't in the tent. She's in the neighboring tent, or she's in the tent. And she hears the three visitors tell Abraham, your wife is going to have a baby. And what does she do? She starts laughing. Oh, that's so funny. Until 9 months later, she has a baby. And they named him Isaac, which means he laughs. Abraham, obedient, follows God, but doesn't always trust God. Sometimes he does what he thinks is right. And his wife says, I think we should do that. He goes along with it. Don't demonize Sarah. He listened to her. But then in this story, Abraham does listen to God's voice. God says, I want you to go to sacrifice your own son. And Abraham says, show me the way. It's very uncomfortable for us to hear. We don't like to think about that. Some say that Abraham was being tested by God because, see, he hadn't been completely faithful. And then Abraham, to truly be the father of Israel, the father of God's people, there was one more test. That's what Ellen Davis says. Dr. Ellen Davis, she's actually was one of my professors at Duke. She wrote in her commentary that God needed to test Abraham one more time before everything came into place. Now, I would think that there would be a different way to test. I'm not comfortable with it, but it's in our story. And we know that Abraham does what he's supposed to. We know the end of the story. We'll get to that in a minute. Who's the second superhero in this passage would be Isaac. Now, when we have our images of Isaac and Abraham walking up the mountain, we often imagine somebody about Emma's size or Emma's age, maybe a little bit older. Because sacrificing his son. Even in our translation today, the messenger from God, which means angel, says, don't hurt the boy. How many of you have children that are over the age of 21 and you still call them boy sometimes or girl? We don't know how old Isaac was. It is very possible that Isaac was a teenager or a young adult when that happened. Now, it could be that Isaac was completely naive. His father says, come, we're going to sacrifice on the altar that I'm going to make up on a mountain. Why don't you follow me, son? And Isaac says, sure, Dad, I'll do whatever you want to do. I'm not worried at all about what's going to happen. And we know from the passage, Isaac says, Father, where is this offering we're supposed to be making? Is that naivety or a little concern? Where is this offering that we're supposed to be making? But yet, if he's naive, that reads one way. If he knew what was happening, it reads another way. Somebody with the wood on their back, walking up a mountain, ready for a sacrifice, sends us into the future, our past, on a similar journey up out of Jerusalem, up onto Skull Hill, Golgotha, where in some of the translations, Jesus is carrying the cross on his own back. I think as Christians, we can read it that way, that there is a sacrifice that needed to be made. There was a sacrifice that was being offered, and the Father was going to be part of the official moment. It's in there, and we read it. We can't deny it. And so what would it mean? What superpower would Isaac have if he knew what was going to happen? Of love, faith, or obedience? Now, maybe God knew that it would never get that far. Maybe this truly was just a test, and it wasn't ever going to be fully accomplished, because immediately the angel says, whoa, stop, time out. Yes, Abraham, you have been faithful, but don't hurt your son. And notice in that passage how many times we are reminded that it was Abraham's only son. Going back to Ishmael. Yes, Abraham had another son, but he loved Isaac more. We also know from the history that is shared in the passages before that after Isaac was born and Sarah had her son, one day she saw Ishmael picking on Isaac, and what did Abraham, you got to get rid of that son of yours. And so Hagar and Ishmael are sent away into the wilderness. But Isaac is Abraham's favorite, the one he waited for until he was in his hundreds before he arrived. Maybe God said, you've done what you were supposed to do. We're going to take care of it. Thank you for your now. You've proven to me your worth. And then they turn around, and what do they see in the thicket but a ram? And the ram takes the place of Isaac. Another reminder, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And I think that is the third superhero. Anybody ever thought of what it would be like to be a ram? I have to admit, I had never really thought about the ram's role in this passage before. It's just an animal. Until I ran across this Hebrew poem, The True Hero of the Akedah. I think that's how you pronounce it. Akedah is the Jewish word that is used to describe this story. This story is so important in the Hebrew faith that it has its own name, the Akedah. The true hero of the Akedah was the ram who did not know about the pact among the others. It was as if he volunteered to die in place of Isaac. I want to sing for him a memorial song about the curly and the mortal eyes, about the horns that stood silent on its living head. After the slaughter, they were made into shofars to sound the blast of their wars and to sound the blast of their base celebrations. I want to remember that final image like a pretty photograph in a fancy fashion magazine, the tanned, pampered youth in his finest of frocks, and by his side, the angel dressed in a long silk gown as if for a festive reception, and the two of them with desolate eyes looking out to two distant desolate places. And behind them, as a colorful background, the ram entangled in the thicket before slaughter, the thicket his final friend. The angel departed homewards, Isaac departed homewards, and Abraham and God had parted ways a while back. But the true hero of the Akedah was the ram. When I read that last night, I was looking for an ending. I texted Jeff. He was downstairs working on his sermon. He's preaching in Rollins today. And I was upstairs working on my sermon. I'm like, I just read this really cool poem, but it's too sad for me to read in worship. He said, well, let me see it. So I emailed it or messaged it to him. He said, you have to read it. I said, but I don't wanna. It's too sad. But the story's already sad. The ram was offered in the place of Isaac, who would have been offered because of Abraham's obedience. The ram was obedient. Maybe it's because it's a mere animal. Maybe there was something special that ram offered itself. Maybe that's reading too much into it. But I think it reminds me that for every action we perform, there are those that are being affected. For everything that we sacrifice, others may be benefiting from it, and others may be affected by it. Because we are a people that is connected with one another. Abraham and Isaac and this ram, they didn't live in isolation, but they were in some kind of community, just as we are. So the superpower today is obedience. And I'm immediately brought to is it a Disney movie? Is Enchanted? Is it Enchanted? No. Which is the one where she has obedience? Ella Enchanted. That's what it is. Ella Enchanted, where her curse is obedience, where she's obedient to everything. Stop hitting me, and then they stop her. You know, stop doing that. I often think obedience isn't a good word. I mean, it wasn't in my marriage vows. Was it in your marriage vows? It's a joke. It's a joke. But yet, to obey God, to obey the call that Christ whispers into our hearts, is what we are called to do as followers of Jesus our Lord. But it is hard to do. Now, I don't think that God is going to ask me to sacrifice my daughter. And Emma said, amen to that. I'm not sure that God is calling us to sacrifice in that way. But what is God calling us to do? What is God calling you to do that maybe you don't want to? That maybe it's hard. Maybe you don't want to love your enemies. Maybe you don't want to be kind to that person that was rude to you in Walmart like we were yesterday. I came home and felt really guilty. Maybe I don't want to love my enemies. Maybe I don't want to love my neighbors. Maybe I don't want to love myself. What is it that God is calling us to do? Thank you for sharing your experience at annual conference, Michelle, because when I came back after annual conference, I was kind of depressed. Not because I was called to sacrifice, but because there's a lot of stress in our churches right now. There's a lot of stress in our denomination right now. There's a lot of stress in the faithful people of God right now. There are a lot of churches that are struggling. There are a lot of pastors and lay people that are struggling. We aren't the only church that looks around and says, where are the people? We aren't the church that looks around and goes, there aren't enough strong people to clean up after the yard sale or to clean up in the yard or to keep it neat. Or there aren't enough people to give what we need to run the church. The newsletter article this month is going to remind us that we've worked really hard as a church, but still our expenses are exceeding our income. And it's not because we're overly spending. We're working the best to minimize our expenses. And it gets draining. When you get the newsletter, read the story about the widow's mite. That will be shared in that article. But it's easier instead to go, I don't have anything, than like the widow to say, I'll give what I can. And it may not be about money. How is God speaking to us as individuals and us as a church to be faithful and obedient to the call of God with all that we are, to love our neighbors and to love ourselves? When we feel down, it's hard to look beyond our emotions instead of looking up and outward into what's around us. Let us listen. Let us pray. Let us take those tiny steps of faith into being more than we can be, because God will provide. It may not be what we think God should provide. We may not, and then 2 weeks from now, have this sanctuary filled with people. But what will God provide us with? The heart, the care, and the love. May we continue to listen and to respond and to lift up one another when sometimes we don't understand. Amen and amen. Moving my stuff here. As we transition now from the word to how we can respond to the word, now is a chance for us to share our joys and our concerns. First, a joy from Dorothy Bankston. She said, thank you for all the birthday wishes. And did she turn 90? Is that what she turned? Anyway, she's like, turning 90, you know, it's not so bad when all these people are being so nice to me. And then another joy, Michael Dentz has a new job starting July 3rd. And many people know that Ruth and Michael Dentz have had a long years, And so we are grateful that things hopefully will be turning around for them. A couple of other concerns to share. Gail Stell, which I haven't talked to you, but she's apparently in the hospital in Denver. Is that right? Still in the hospital in Denver. She's... So Gail is not doing well, but she may be back up here in the Cheyenne Hospital soon. Ashley is still traveling around in Europe, and she'll be home soon. I know that Meshin is now in her mission trip over in Bali, and so we pray for her. Linda, Sean Horton's mother, was supposed to know whether she was learning a diagnosis of cancer or not this week. Wendy Horton's mother, June, is having heart valve replacement surgery on June 27th. We're praying for Dee Melander's friend, Susie, and we're praying for a six-month-old who died last week and for all the emergency providers that were affected by that death. So Emma wants to share that I will be going to the doctor on July 3rd to check with the surgeon about my gallbladder. So I may or may not have surgery on that, but some of you have had gallbladder surgery since I've been in the church. I will know more after I visit with them on Monday the 3rd, so a little over a week. We do have one other announcement for the Spirit Award, and then we'll do the birthdays and anniversaries. You can go get the birthday cake.
So it becomes difficult to do the Spirit Award when you have to work around people's vacations. If people would not leave during the summertime, this would not be an issue. But we'd like to present this award today to somebody who a lot of times you may not even know is here in service because he's buried back in the sound booth. He's been involved in youth mission trips. He's been involved in United Methodist Men. And so Roger Mork, come up. So, and this is the Spirit Award that we would like to present you with, Roger, because we know that sometimes the people that are the least seen are the ones doing the most work. And there's a quote on here by Albert Schweitzer that says, "In everyone's life, at some time, our inner fire goes out. It is then burst into flame by, I don't have my glasses on, an encounter with another human being. Be thankful for those people who rekindle the inner spirit." And so we'd like to present you with the June Spirit Award. Thank you. Thank you. You want to say anything?
No.
And sometimes those that receive the Spirit Award are like, don't talk to me. I like being in the background. But now we're going to shamelessly embarrass those that are having birthdays and anniversaries this week. So June 26th is Kathy Orr. So we're going to, happy birthday, Kathy. June 30th is Jade Webb, which is Bev Webb's grandson, granddaughter. June 25th anniversary, that would be today, Russell and Kirsten Anderson are celebrating 6 years. And then June 27th, we have our dynamic duo couple of Orville and Ruth Cousins, and Bobby and Mary Lou Barkham are both been married, or all four have been married for 63 years, just not to each other. Or some to each other, but not to the other. So if you see them, say happy anniversary to them. So let us continue as we know our birthdays and celebrations. There are concerns and challenges in our lives. What you have in your pews are some strips of paper. If you want to fill out your prayer concern, and if you want to put it on the continuing our prayer chain, you can either do it on the inside so that it's completely confidential, or on the outside so that people can see. We are treating these as confidential. So if you have a prayer concern that you would like to share out loud in worship and on our emails, please write them on a prayer card. We know it's double duty for you. But this is really an opportunity for those prayers to be lifted up to God, directly from you to God. So let us continue with a moment of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and Holy One, we come today to worship you, to praise you, and even to say we don't understand how you work in our lives, God. There are so many things that we understand. There are so many questions or even concerns that are on our hearts. We read your holy word, God, and sometimes we leave more baffled than determined and assured. Sometimes we come into worship and we are filled with the Spirit, and other times we're worrying about what we have to do when we get home or those things we forgot to do yesterday, and we don't mean anything about it, God. We just have so many things on our hearts and on our minds and on our shoulders. So, Lord, help to clear our minds of those burdens. Help us to recenter ourselves, our spirit. Speak to us. Tap us on the shoulder so that we turn around and see you right by our side. We give you thanks, O God, for those joys that were lifted up today. We are thankful, Lord, for the people that work tirelessly in our church, not for money, not for accolades, or not to get some kind of plaque they can put on their wall, but because they have a servant's heart, because you have asked them to serve in some way that not everybody sees, and they are willing to say, "Here I am, God." We also pray, O God, for those in our midst that are struggling, those that are being challenged by life circumstances, whether it's cancer, whether it's not being able to breathe, or a heart not working right, or other body parts that just aren't working as they're supposed to. Or maybe, God, for those that are struggling in ways that can't be seen on the outside, but struggles of the spirit, of the mind, of the emotions. No person is too hurt for your love. No person is too far away from you running after us. May all that, may we count on that, may we trust that truth, that you are with us always. We lift up those prayer concerns that were spoken out loud, the ones on the screen, and the ones spoken in our hearts. We pray, God, for those in our midst who have loved ones that are serving in our armed forces, in our military, and in other ways, maybe the emergency responders. Be with them as they do your work to provide healing and peace in a world that is broken and hurting. And we pray for our church. Lord, you're not done with us yet. We are still your beloved. You call us to love. You call us to serve. You don't call us to be what we used to be, but you call us to be who we can be today. May we be filled with the superpower of faith and obedience. May we be your people. And may we know that your Son, who died for us, is living in us, speaking to us, challenging us, and that your Spirit is causing us to get out of our seats and out into your world. May we celebrate that today. And we pray all these things in the name of Christ and in the power of the Spirit. And now we pray the words that our Lord taught us, our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And as God's people, let us give thanks and let us share the peace of Christ as we stand and greet one another this morning.
We do.
You're invited to bring up your prayer concern and put it onto the chain. You can do that now, or you can do that as the ushers come forward, because now is a chance for us to find our seats and to give thanks for the ways that God has blessed us and the ways that we are called to share with God and with this church and the ministries that we have as our ushers come forward for God's tithes and our offerings. Let us join together in our prayer of dedication. Generous God, you are the source of abundant life. You reveal a great mystery. Those who lose their life for the sake of your Son will find it. When we are aware of loss, send your Holy Spirit to help us trust in your steadfast love. You are transforming our lives and this world as surely as you have transformed the cross by Christ's resurrection. Let our gifts bring vitality to the healing ministries of this community of faith. With this, in the name of our risen Lord Jesus, amen. Please be seated. And now our announcements for the week.
As we come to worship, we'll also come to respond. We come to worship and we leave to serve. We respond to God's call and the Holy Spirit by serving him and others. The worship helpers this summer we need are liturgists, readers theater, this was fun, and communers like we're going to need next Sunday. And we have two readers already. One reader. Okay. All right. All right. And communion servers. We need one more reader. The sign-up sheet for those would be in the narthex, or you want to talk to Reverend Laura. Those who are reading next week will have your scripts in your boxes, and you might want to meet about 9:45 just to go over some of the names of those scriptures. We have a really big park out here, our lawn, so we need some people to cut the grass and trim the lawn, and you might make a party out of it because the riding mower is broken. So you'll have to bring your own, and like three or four of you could go up and down and just mow that sucker down. Alrighty. Like Michelle has mentioned, when you give to our church, the Outreach Assistant Fund, it sure helps all the people that we can in our community, the people in need, and because of you, our member aid fund is very healthy, and we want to thank you for that, right? Happy are those who find wisdom and those who understand. Amen?
So now let us stand and sing our closing hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. I invite you to take the hand of the one next to you. You may have to stretch out a little bit, because when we hold hands, we remember that we are. We do not walk through this life together. We are not challenged alone, but together. And as we leave this place and go out into the world that needs to hear the good news, may we know that the grace of God, the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit are with us now and always. Amen. And amen.
do a dual